Francesco Chianese. He is a Fulbright scholar in residence at the California State University in Long Beach. His talk today is entitled Looking for Casa, Home and Belonging in John Fante's Wait Until Spring, Bandini, Joseph Tusiani's In Una Casa, Un'altra Casa, Trovo, e Igiaba Scego's La Mia Casa e Dove Sono.
Today I will talk about casa. The concept of home is a crucial element in traditional Italian culture, which needs to be reconceptualized in accordance with a new axiology in relation to the Italian experience of migration. In my paper, I will build a discourse between three significantly diverse cases that all relate to the concept of home and migration within contemporary Italian culture. The first case is John Fante's novel Wait Until Spring, Bandini, 1938, in which the US-born Italian writer narrates his experience as the son of Italian immigrants to Colorado. The second example is In Una Casa, Un'altra Casa, Trovo, 2016, autobiography of Italian poet Joseph Tusiani, who has migrated to the United States to join his father and rebuild his family nest. The last one is Igiaba Scego's memoir, La Mia Casa Dove Sono, 2010, which addresses issues concerning the recent second-generation Italian-born children of African origins who attempt to make Italy their home. All the books mentioned represent home by reflecting on the notion of family and identity suspended between two distinct cultures. In the earlier novel of Fante, from the viewpoint of protagonist Arturo Bandini, home seems to be a place to escape from in order to become a true American. But the protagonist also identifies his home as the house his father would never buy, and the failure of his father's American dream. Conversely, Tusiani's idea of finding a home in his new home a new house closely resembles Scego's advanced feeling of belonging, according to which her home is wherever she is situated, by recalling her mother's nomadic childhood. At the extreme hands of the most recent definition of Italy, seen as a land of emigration and immigration, in the cases considered, Italianness is continuously rewritten from different perspectives. Within this wider understanding of Italian culture, my aim is to analyze how home can identify a hybrid cultural space that leads to a truly transnational and transcultural concept of Italianness, in which Scego's notion of scrittura meticcia finds its place. I believe we should start by trying to identify what home is, why this concept is different from house, why it is culturally relevant that Italians never thought they needed two specific words and just used the word casa for both, and why this might be relevant to my comparison. But firstly, I would like to briefly outline my current primary area of research within the field of Italian diaspora studies. It focuses on the cultural representation of two issues affecting Italians in migration, which are family transformation and the quest for home. At the beginning, I was working on them separately. Then many discussions with our panel chair, Fred Gardaphe, made me reevaluate the interconnected nature of those two fields. In a quite recent article on RSA Journal from 2016, by elaborating on Benedict Anderson's definition of home in major communities, Gardaphe highlighted that for Italian Americans, home is not a geographic place, it is rather related to family, which is, and I quote, the place where Italian American identity is most likely to be learned and preserved, end of quote. Before Gardaphe, Gaetano Conte had related those issues to each other in one of the first studies on the Little Italy by recalling his experience in Boston's North End in the Italian in America, 1906. However, I believe the most accurate reflection on the relationship between Italians, Italian families, and houses so far is provided by Robert Viscusi in Il Caso della Casa, a chapter from his classic Bird Caesar, 2005. I hope Fred is not offended by this. His project dates back to 1979, the year I was born. This means that this work has been going on for a period that is as old as myself, and that my paper is grounded in quite a long and established tradition of studies. Therefore, I am conducting this research on family transformation and home as a part of a wider reconsideration of the topic within the same theoretical framework. Similarly to how I have been addressing topics related to Italian-American culture in their wider conceptualization as a part of a broader field of studies on the Italian diaspora. The first version of this paper was presented at the symposium organized by the Calandra Institute at the University of Calabria in summer 2017, and shortly after, with some updates, at the AD conference in Palermo. In truth, in the last year I've been working primarily on Pasolini for the book I recently published, so not much progress has been made in this context. Nonetheless, I was really lucky because two crucial publications have since contributed to this dialogue. Laura Roberta's and Joseph Shore's essay collection on the Italian new migration to the United States 2017 and 2018, which was announced in the period I presented the first paper. And within this collection, in volume two, Anthony Tamburi afterward, Rethinking Labels, the Italian writer as example of distinct categories as quixotic, 2018, which focuses on the possibility of including all the cultural representation of migrations related to Italy, outgoing from Italy, as well as ongoing to Italy. Consequently, the ground on which my research is built has strengthened just in time for me to get started. How convenient is that? This is it, I would say, the story so far about a research paper that once more is to be considered as a starting point rather than to an arrival. What this paper is about, then? As Tusiani's autobiography and Scego's memoir are written in Italian, like Fante's novel, which is written in English, it is worth noting that Tusiani and Scego use the word casa for both meaning of house and home, which already tells us something important about Italian culture. Nonetheless, I found it quite easy to identify when they are using casa to refer to home rather than to house, as they use the word as a metaphor many times. Furthermore, as in Scego, the book announces itself as a story of a quest for home through the title. Viscusi as well starts his discourse from the Italian word casa, then highlighting the differences that in English identify house as a building for human habitation and home as a place identified through a sense of belonging. Viscusi starts from the assumption that for a migrant, house stands for homeland in the first instance. I quote, Italian-American is most frequently, most easily to be found in Italian houses in America. In these places, the house is one of the several is in one of several possible senses, the old country itself. End of quote. Italian migrants place in their house everything they want to bring from Italy to feel comfortable and find stability in their new condition. And their house becomes home when this place satisfies this basic requirement. As the title of Tusiani's book says, the settlement works when he finds his house another home, which is something Italians have in common with people migrating from any other place in the world, I believe. Nonetheless, Viscusi highlights that from Italians, this quest is a matter of passion. This passion reveals a passion for stability. Italians have been pursuing and building houses. I'm quoting. Italians have been pursuing and building houses, case, in the medieval sense. Our house means family, and family means houses, for more than a century in Italian America, and doing so with standing dedication, end of quote. Again, for Italians, home is part of the wider family framework. Before the diffusion of the nuclear family model, Italians felt at home only when all the family were under the same roof. After the diffusion of the nuclear family model, they wanted their relatives' house to be as close as each other as possible in order to have frequent meetings in which they could all gather together. By mentioning Mario Puzo's The Fortunate Pilgrim, Viscusi underlines that Puzo identifies house with family and family with food. Viscusi attempts to sketch a specific theory to examine the stories that writers told as related to their experience with houses. He listed four ways in which a house becomes an Italian home. The house can be a shrine, a villa, a palazzo, or an embassy. Every variety describes a different family narrative. The shrine is related to the Oedipal model of the escaping son, il figlio prodigo, who always have a place to come back to. The villa to the opposite model of Aeneas as a successful immigrant who carries his father with him. The palazzo stands from the community where all neighbors can gather and feel like they are in the paese. And then the embassy, which, and I quote, achieves its ability by accepting its own impermanence, its own provisionality, end of quote, through generations. According to Viscusi, La Casa Italoamericana must do more than offer, La Casa Italoamericana must do more than offer shelf space to old Caruso records or a place in the garden to wrap the fig tree in winter. It must do even more than impress the all-seeing cousins. It must turn its face outward, as the embassy does. It must surely keep it inward gaze, recalling the strenuous doubling of the mind that makes immigrant Italians into Italian Americans. End of quote. By building on Viscusi's assumption, my argument extends the discourse in quite different directions. By considering the new perception of Italy as a land of both immigration and emigration, and of Italian culture historically defined by a constant flow of people incoming and outgoing, in this paper I am referring to the space of the house perceived as a space of belonging. Two of my cases approach home directly in their title, La mia casa dove sono, and In una casa un'altra casa trovo. By starting from my last case study, Scego's book addresses issue concerning the second-generation immigrant Italian population by telling her own story of a child born in Rome to Somali parents belonging to the colonial past of Italy in 1974. The second example concerned the story of an Italian who migrated to the United States to join his father and rebuild his family in 1948. It is a case of post-war migration with all the implications and specific issues highlighted by Roberto Insciora in the above-mentioned two-volume collection. In the wide field of autobiographical narratives of Italians who migrated to the United States before the war, which includes celebrated masterpieces such as Jerry Mangione's Montalegre, 1943, what makes Tusiani's case original is its belonging to this new wave of migration to the United States. While Mangione's book is focused on the experience of the first wave of mass migration to Italy and follows and confirms the recurrent path of arrival, acclimation, and assimilation, conversely, Tusiani helps to individuate a singular voice to the big frame of the discontinuities identified in the second wave of Italian migration to the US. It specifically constitutes a case of rebooting of the culture Italians built in Arthur Avenue in the Bronx, Little Italy, by contributing with its singular voice to a revitalization of Italian American literature and an expansion into new trajectories. By contrast, my third term of comparison, which is the first case study I will present, goes back to the narrative of the first wave of migrations and provides a counter-narrative to Tusiani. John Fante's much earlier novel, Wheatland and Spring Bandini, narrates Fante's experience as a second-generation Italian-American and growing up during the Great Depression. Fante's novel is formally the only fictional book of the three. Nonetheless, it has been defined by most critics, overruled by Stephen Cooper, as Fante's most autobiographical book. Fante's novel provided the starting point of my reflection. From its very title, it introduces a story of expectation and disappointment. It suggests a spring to come, which for the American born teenager Arturo translates into the struggle within the family context, from which he wants to escape to achieve the process of Americanization. For Arturo, Italianness is perceived as a shame and an obstacle, as he sees in his own Italian heritage, his father's Svevo prison, as well as the failure of Svevo's American dream. Conversely, it represents for Arturo's parents the misery of the Italian experience of first-generation Italians in the US, as well as their discomfort as a result of displacement to such a different place from the motherland. From any viewpoint, no sense of home nor belonging is related to the Bandini's house in the novel. Svevo is the first character to be introduced in the book, and the one who shows the most problematic relationship toward his house. On the first page, we find him swearing against the snow. The reader gets rapidly accustomed to Svevo's swearing, as in the activity that defines his character. The whole first chapter is focused on the swearing of Svevo against the snow, against Arturo, against his family, but mostly against the house that seems to contain all those. While describing Svevo, Fante accurately separates home from house, even though both concepts highlight his frustration as a family man. In the first example, as you can see, Svevo uses the word home to underline a feeling of nostalgia and displacement common to most of the Italian-American narratives addressing the experience of first-generation immigrants. Home is Abruzzi, is lost homeland. In the second passage, Svevo shifts from home to house. He highlights Svevo's detachment from the place where his wife and therefore his family lives. In the following pages, one discovers that Svevo's unhappiness is deeply rooted in his family relationships. In the third passage, Svevo individuates a further distance between the place he calls house and the possibility it can become home, the difficulties related to the possession of the place, which highlights his poor living conditions. To sum up, displacement, family discomfort, and poverty are the element that prevents Svevo's perception of his house as home. In terms of time and space, the US described by Tusiani is quite different from the US described by Fante. In only 10 years, Roosevelt's New Deal recharged post-war America with an energy and optimism that was not existent in the Depression era. Furthermore, the atmosphere of the Italian Bronx was rather different from that of the cold cities where Italian masons and miners were living in difficult condition in Colorado. One significant difference from Fante is that in Tusiani's narrative, the most relevant events happen in houses, and especially at the protagonist's house. The metaphor applies more to Tusiani's notion of home as a family nest, rather than a place built as a house. In fact, before finding a home, Tusiani's narrative relates the experience of several houses. After arriving, Joseph and his mother are taken to their relatives and co-regionals from San Marco in Lamis. Their community organized the greatest welcome possible to make them feel at home. Nonetheless, his uncle Giuseppe warns him about the house where he's being taken, which is not his home yet. First example. The second house Tusiani visits in the book is not home either. It is architect Nicola Giusto's house. Giusto is said to be a true Italian, or a real Italian, as in Roberto Sanchoro's definition. But the experience of meeting him turns out to be very disappointing. As one reads on his door, the message to his visitors is very clear. In questa casa non si parla il maledetto inglese. Giusto is an angry man due to his inability to develop any skill in English during his entire life experience in the US, which made it impossible to undertake any employment and condemned him to poor old age with plenty of resentment. The freshly arrived Joseph, full of enthusiasm and a desire to improve his condition, is rapidly banned from the place for spontaneously using some English. Nonetheless, Tusiani is soon welcomed by another house which seems to have a better chance of becoming a home for him, sculptor Onore Ruotolo's house. A higher cultural range of Italian artists from Manhattan meet there, who exhibit their Italian pride without condemning their new American residents, among whom Tusiani feels more at ease. Writer Frances Winward, born Francesca Vinciguerra, is one of them. At her house, Tusiani finds his home. Francesca Vinciguerra encourages Tusiani to use English in his poems. The quest for home in Tusiani, translated into a more complex reflection on the belonging of an Italian to his own country when he lives abroad. The book collected and re-elaborates the contents of a three-volume narrative published between 1988 and 1992 under a new title. The most remarkable difference is the title itself. The previous edition was labeled under the word parola, as it is appropriate for a poet, la parola difficile, la parola nuova, la parola antica. It is extremely significant to note that in the new edition, nearly 30 years after the first one, the writer replaces the quest for the word with the quest for home. What Scego adds to this picture is a remarkable use of the metaphor of home as originating from her nomadic mother's past, which results as a very profitable in the framework previously developed. In fact, the book's title, La mia casa dove sono, is related to her mother's often spoken phrase, La casa ce la portavamo sulle spalle, as you see in the screen, which one finds on the very first page of the book. The image of Scego's mother, who was used to literally carrying her house on her shoulders as part of the traditional nomadic Somali culture, is powerful and appropriate. The resulting concept of house as something that one can carry with oneself and that cannot be reduced to just one place, irrelevant to several contexts of migrations. She often mentions her lost motherland, Somalia. Consequently, for Scego, home is not a specific commonplace, but the place where her family is together. Curiously enough, Scego brings me to an Italian-American case, that of Elena Barolini's novel Umbertina, and to Viscusi's theory. As Viscusi wrote, and I quote, Umbertina is a book about planting, about finding a house and a center that we hold, end of quote. Nonetheless, each of the women in the book, and I quote again, inhabits several houses, and all of them come to similar conclusions. Guilt and fear, like nostalgia, keep roots from sinking. Every house, the last, does so because it values itself, where and as it stands, end of quote. More than through the process of finding a house, highlighted by Tusiani, Barolini's characters achieve their stability by accepting their own impermanence, their house's provisionality, just like Scego. Scego brings us back to the idea of the case embassy, but by specifying that she can carry it with herself, as her mother used to do. In this way, Scego's conclusion is not far from that of third-generation Tina, which embodies Helen Barolini's survival point as a writer, and individuates her house as a transportable place that provides stability in his provisionality. A transnational Italian house made of few objects which can constitute a home everywhere. Home then becomes a flexible concept, and the sense of belonging to an Italian context becomes a transnational perception of this context concept, which highlights that belonging to the same framework, framework depicted by Tamburi when he writes, and I quote, "The triangulation of so-called migrants within Italy who write in Italian, Italian language writers who live outside of Italy, and let us add Italian-American writers, may seem an odd grouping of writers of distinct and disparate categories. I would submit, instead, that they are kindred spirits who share a closer relationship than some might imagine. They are all dialoguing to some degree or another with the sign we know as Italy, that is the metaphorical centrifuge of which the three groups make up the content." Thank you.
Maria Christine Michaud. Her talk today is a representation of transnational ties in Italian-American fiction, the example of the coming of Fabrizze.
Okay, thank you very much, Fred. And I'm very happy to be here and to deliver this speech in front of you. So The Coming of Fabrizze was written in 1960 by Raymond De Capite. This is a novel that underlines how the Italian identity of the main characters, who are immigrants, is in motion, a process notably due to the interaction between transnationalism and integration. So this is the story of Fabrizze, a young Italian from the Abruzzi, who was taken to Michigan by his cousin Augustine when he returned to his village for a short visit. Then the book deals with Fabrizio's mobility in America, his occupational mobility, as he was first a water boy for the local railroad company and became a supervisor of a gang. His social mobility, he became the owner of a store of imported goods and one of the prominenti of the community. And his economic mobility, since he invested thousands of dollars in the stock market and then he became rich. He managed to succeed by integrating the American capitalist system, but at the end of the book, the stock exchange collapsed and Fabrizze was ruined. However, he remained optimistic and faithful to the American system. He didn't want to return to Italy, and he even contemplated having additional relatives come from Italy to America, which still appeared like a land of promises, a land of opportunities. His life is embedded in interconnections between his village of origin and his life in America. Thus, it can be said that The Coming of Fabrizze is an illustration of the importance of transnational ties in the experience of migrants. So let me first give some definitions concerning transnationalism. As Dino Chinnell showed, ties, and these are in the chronological order, as Dino Chinnell shows, ties between immigrants and the motherlands are usually maintained for a while and tend to wither progressively after one or two generations, because along with the process of integration in the foster society, the identity of Italian immigrants tends to be altered. It's revealed to be in the making in an everlasting evolution. In southern Italy, emigration was essential. There was no social or national solidarity. Villages were isolated and competition among peasants was harsh. Such a life depended on immigration and the maintenance of links between immigrants and their village of origin. Italians abroad helped their family to live on an economic point of view, when simultaneously the relations with the families helped immigrants to feel comfortable on a psychological point of view. To know that they still had a part to play in their village and family lives constituted a target for their daily struggle in the foster country. Indeed, returns and remittances were crucial. They were expected as emigration was seen as a solution to fight misery. So transnationalism has always been part of the migration movements, even if it was not highly visible and took multiple forms. Generally speaking, men went abroad to work and sent remittances to their wives, who waited for their returns. For example, this is what Donna Gabaccia maintained in her book, Italy's Many Diasporas. As soon as 1916, Randolph Bourne had referred to transnational America, as migration was stimulating relationships between America and the countries where immigrants had come from. Immigrants kept close ties with their countries of origin and could not forget their roots. Americanization failed, and for Bourne, there was no distinctive American culture, but America had a unique character due to the impact of migration and transnationalism, which appeared like a force in the incoming country. This internationalist approach could have inspired Stephen Vertovec when he explained that there had always been forms of transnational ties, that is to say, individuals once abroad have always kept some forms of contact with their countries of origin. Vertovec defined transnationalism as exchanges of communication and information along with some participation in social, cultural, and political activities. Nowadays, transnationalism has adopted different forms due to the progress in technology and means of communication due to globalization. So to keep transnational ties is easier and quicker, and to be here and there, to have a kind of dual life, is different from what these ties were at the beginning of the 20th century. But what is important to remember is that transnationalism is not new. It is often used to describe diverse situations, and the definition that Glick Schiller and her colleagues gave provided a contemporary theoretical framework to transnationalism. According to anthropologists Nina Glick Schiller, Linda Bash, Christina Blank Swanson, migrants are said to be transmigrant when they have social activities in several countries, their countries of birth and their countries of adoption. Transnationalism is the process by which immigrants forge and sustain multi-stranded social relations that link together the societies of origin and settlement, unquote. So individuals develop multiple activities which lead to the building of a network and interconnections between the country of origin and the country of adoption. So migrants do not feel isolated. And one of the main consequences of these interactions is the fact that the identity of migrants is no longer attached to one particular territory, but becomes transnational since they feel that they could participate in the social, political, economic, and cultural life of several nations. In other words, transnationalism brings about a change in the identity of transmigrants who are building their identity across national boundaries. There is a mutual impact of the several countries on individuals. Transmigrants can exert some influence in the country of origin, and at the same time, their homeland had a role to play in their lives in the foster country. But migrants are not necessarily transmigrant, as some were reluctant to have activities in their country of adoption, for example, when they were birds of passage, and they did not keep many ties with the village of origin because of the distance and the difficulties to communicate. When individuals intend to return home, the transnational ties are even stronger because to remain connected with one's family is felt as necessary. So now let's see transnationalism and Fabrizze and the coming of Fabrizze. According to these definitions, we can say that Fabrizze, the protagonist of the capitalist novel, is a transmigrant. The action of the novel takes place within the Italian-American community of Cleveland, Ohio, but Fabrizze represents a link between the Abruzzi and America. The first chapter deals with the temporary return of Augustine in his village when he tells his stories about his experience in America, which makes the villagers and Fabrizze eager to emigrate. Then Augustine goes back to America with his cousin, Fabrizze, and the action of the novel takes place exclusively within the ethnic community of Cleveland. The fact that the novel opens in Italy is revealing of the network that exists between migrants and their village. It shows how chain migration works and how connections can be maintained. The novel mainly deals with Fabrizze's activities, and I shall focus on the transnational activities, obviously. According to Glick Schiller's words, we can say that Fabrizze has multiple transnational social activities. He wants to trigger chain migration. The novel displays the cyclical movement of migration, how the two countries are linked thanks to transmigrants, their travels and their activities. De Capite insists on some activities. For example, some of the male characters intend to go to Italy to find a wife. For example, so these are the quotations, okay. For example, Gritti and Pipino have done so after exchanging letters with their relatives in the village and after some arrangements with the girls' fathers. Such a practice echoes a system of picture brides. We can also say that it comes from the attachment of the family, traditional family life, when men prefer to marry Italian women. The situation comes from the fact that emigration was a migration of workers. In northern states, for example, at the beginning of the 20th century, Italians comprised 75% of the workers on the railroad. In the novel, the male characters worked for the local railroad company and constitute an Italian gang. Fabrizze, as the leader of the gang, manages to have other Italians, already in Cleveland or in Italy, work for the company. The importance of networks is then underlined. The correspondence between migrants and their family in the homeland is mentioned and furnishes useful information for individuals as well as the community about deaths, weddings, and so how to organize the coming of relatives to prepare the settlement of newcomers and their employment. This transnational correspondence is instrumental in the functioning of chain migration. Along with transnational correspondence, De Capite insists on remittances, which constitutes another essential transnational link. Those who send remittances exert some influence, economic and social mainly, on their family state in the homeland. As their evidence of the economic success of immigrants, they constitute an additional element that triggers migration. And at the same time, they can decide villagers to emigrate. In the novel, many passages are devoted to the importance of remittances. And let's notice that to send remittances can be considered as a sacrifice for immigrants. They have left their home for their family's sake to find a job and earn money. And abroad, they have to save money to send remittances. And for example, Augustine acknowledges that, I quote, he was in chains, end quote. Remittances may be used to make life easier in Italy and to pay the fare of the journey to America. Fabrizze, because he had saved money, thanks to his investments, feels that it is his duty to have other Italians come and to take profit of the opportunities of America. And for example, he wants to have his grandmother come. I'm saving to send for my grandmother, we'll be together again. And here we can see the importance of the to be together again. So to have families reunited across boundaries. And he is even ready to return to Italy to have other Italians come. Grace, his wife, even suggested him to have old villagers come. This is the second part of the quotation. Returns, temporary or permanent, play a significant role in transnationalism because returnees are new men with savings, new ideas, more modern ideas, very often, as Dino Chinnell noticed. And they can constitute a model. They can convince other villagers to emigrate by being examples of success and by taking them to America in the case of temporary stay. This is what Augustine had done at the beginning of the novel and what Fabrizze is then ready to do. Fabrizze owns a store of imported goods. The store keeps the sense of belonging and solidarity alive among the members of the community. It quickly becomes the heart of the community, and the author gives extensive details about the items sold there, ham, pepper, cheese, wine, etc. The food and wine available in the store are familiar products that show that migrants are still attached to their traditional way of living and in exchange with their country of origin to feel comfortable. Symbolically, one of Fabrizio's friends, Ramboni, has kept a cup filled with some earth from the Abruzzi. This is the quotation. So a cup filled with some earth from the Abruzzi, even if he considers that America is his home, in fact, the home of all the Italian Americans he lives with, in Fabrizze especially. So this interconnection with the village of origin permits Fabrizze to feel comfortable and to integrate the American system. For example, he gives an American name to his son, Paul, and has already asked for naturalization papers. So what about integration and transnationalism? Fabrizze is an example of integration. He climbed the social ladder and becomes prosperous by investing money in the stock exchange and believing in the capitalist system. But he is still deeply attached to the village of origin and wants to play a social role there. So integration and transnationalism are not incompatible, but complementary. Their interaction gives birth to a new identity, since men forged their existence upon two social and cultural systems that, to quote Greg Schiller once more, link together the societies of origin and settlement. Here, Fabrizze supports the capitalist system that American society is based upon, while still being attached to and practicing Italian habits, which is symbolized by a store of imported goods and the maintenance of ties with his village. Such an identity gives a new existence to the group, as Philip Gleason wrote, because the construction of identity is a process and goes along with the processes of self-identification and socialization. Fabrizze changes his way of life, invests money in the American system, learns English, he tends to become an American citizen. Simultaneously, he sees himself as an agent between Italians in Italy and the Little Italy of Cleveland. He shared between the two systems, still feels Italian, but will stay in the US to provide a better life to his friends and children. So the book is an example of the construction of an Italian-American identity at the beginning of the century, intermingling the promises of America and the roots in Italy. This dual identity comes from the interaction between the two countries to which the characters are attached, their interaction between integration and transnationalism. As their integration is not complete, as they are shared between the two social and cultural systems, we can say that their dual identity is still in the making. In the novel, this is shown by the fact that at the end, the characters do not know if Fabrizze has returned to Italy or not, in other words, to which country he belongs to, even if the readers eventually learn that he has stayed in the US. In fact, he had gone to Chicago because he was ashamed to stay in the community because he had advised his friends to invest money in the in the stock exchange, and they were all ruined. So he wanted to stay in the US. The characters' investments failed to make them rich in the long run as the stock exchange collapsed, but they still believed in the American system. This situation encapsulates the hesitation, the doubts, the hardships inherent to the process of integration, and the understanding in the foster society. It also reveals the flaws of American society in integrating foreigners, the unkept promises of the new world. But the capitalist view remains optimistic, and the characters stay in the US and are ready to make further investments. Their integration is still in the making, their Italian-American identity still in motion. And the novel ends up with an image of springtime, of hope, and a reference to the essential role of transnationalism in experience of immigrants. And this is evident in the words spring, gay flashing days, and sweet. Thank you very much for your attention.
My work is not really on Italian Americans, so I never knew how well it would fit with the Calandra Institute, but it's definitely on transnationalism because it's on the meanings of Italy to US women. So let me begin. We know the image. Audrey Hepburn on the back of a Vespa, streaking through the streets of Rome, falling in love with Gregory Peck, becoming an independent woman in the process. To the American post-war audience watching Roman Holiday in 1953, Italy appeared as a place that allowed physical freedom and romantic possibility for women. Scholars contend that this favorite vision of Italy is actually a historic one, rooted in conceptions of 19th century American travelers, inspired by books such as Madame de Stael's popular 1807 novel, Corinne or Italy. But note that Hepburn, like most heroines in any Italy romance narrative, is white. In fact, due to factors economic and cultural, historically few American women of color have seemed to have written about Italy, nor do we frequently see representations of black women there. This morning I'm going to consider the question, what does Italy, both as a place and an imagined idea, mean to black women, American black women? So for white women, from Margaret Fuller to Elizabeth Gilbert more recently, they've written about Italy as a transformative site since at least the 19th century. And while white women have done this, before the late 20th century, few black women visited Italy and fewer wrote about it. Our critic Charmaine Nelson has explained how the extreme class and racial segregation of 19th century ship travel imposed material and physical hardships on black travelers. The experience of travel for free blacks in the 19th century, she says, was like the transport of black cargo in slavery, structured by the immobilization of the black body. And yet there were, of course, some notable exceptions. For example, the sculptor Edmonia Lewis found that time in Rome allowed her more freedom to study and work than she had in the U.S. But on the whole, U.S. culture has few representations of U.S. black women spending time in Italy. This is even true today. And yet, rarely, we can see black women attracted to the power of the Italian romance narrative. A 2018 television show on the Bravo network called To Rome for Love chronicles the five-week adventures of a group of U.S. black women going to Italy to find romance. The coordinator of this love holiday, as they called it, this is a reality show, right, so it's not a scripted show. The love coordinator assures them that men in Italy appreciate black women in ways U.S. men do not. As she explains it, black women complain they have a hard time finding love in America, and one woman on the tour claims that American men often find them, quote, too outspoken or, quote, too ghetto. However, despite this evidence of the contemporary lore of love in Italy, even to black women today, we must acknowledge that a black woman visiting the peninsula today faces racism, or could face racism, shall I say. Recent Italian football matches reveal a not very hidden anti-black racism today, at least partly fueled by anti-immigrant sentiment. This is a quote, a Negro cannot be Italian was a chant that met Italian footballer Mario Balotelli along with a barrage of bananas on the field. In an even more disturbing example of Italian racism, a 2018 gunman said to be targeting black people opened fire on pedestrians in Macerata. You might remember that. And a 2018 recent headline in The Guardian proclaims, quote, Italy used to be a tolerant country, now racism is rising. A few women of color in particular have shared their experience of prejudice on the peninsula. Joanna Brett Martin's 2016 self-published book, Involuntary Racism, Reflections of an African-American Woman in Italy, examines at length the racism she experienced living there. Tracing racial prejudice to the Italian spirit of campanilismo, the rivalry between towns, Martin records her own experiences. In one example, she tells of the Italian who assumed she was an African prostitute because of her skin color. Quanto vuoi? How much do you want? He asked her. In another, she describes the Italian bureaucrat who had no trouble keeping immigrants waiting because, quote, they're just a bunch of Moroccans and Albanians, end quote. Martin even points to the racism she sees inherent in the Italian language. One of her examples is in cazzo nero, literally black mad, figuratively steaming mad. Similarly, several years ago, I interviewed a professional American black woman living in Naples who had grown to hate the city because it was a nightmare for her to walk in the streets. This was completely shocking to me. I love Naples. I thought everybody would love Naples. She said Italians were either propositioning her when she was on the street or throwing epithets at her, assuming she was an immigrant. So far from experiencing a freewheeling Neapolitan holiday, this woman was pretty isolated and living a pretty limited life. So it would seem that in many ways, Italy does not offer black women the same liberatory romantic experience it has historically offered to whites. Thus, it may come as no surprise that as one of few African-American women to set her stories in Italy, Andrea Lee resolutely resists the Italy love plot in her work. And today I'm going to talk about her 2006 novel, Lost Hearts in Italy. But while Lee's novel decidedly rejects the love plot, it still affirms the transformative power that the idea of Italy has historically held for U.S. women since at least Margaret Fuller. Lee finds expansive identities for her characters in Italy outside of romance narratives. Her characters find freedom by breaking out of the heterosexual binary of lover-beloved through what she calls a kaleidoscope of racial and national identities. As such, her novel suggests that Italy, the idea perhaps more than the place, inspires expansive identities for women across racial lines, even when the Italy romance plot disappoints. The complex racial identities of Lee's female characters are notable from the outset of Lost Hearts in Italy. With her class privilege, the main African-American character, Mira, occupies a liminal space between races, nations, and cultures. The novel opens with her as a young woman on a plane to join her white husband, Nick, in Rome. Mira is, quote, good at going into new worlds, at being a foreigner. She is one of the generation of black children pushed out of the bourgeois ghetto of their parents to become pioneers in private schools and camps that before the 70s had never admitted a black or a Jew. She's used to the feeling of being inside yet not watching. End quote. She comes to, quote, look generically foreign, a woman who belongs more to her age and social class and painstaking elegance than to a particular country. While she and her husband at times experience their American identity as a shared culture, as an expat, Mira is not all American. She dreams that at times she is, quote, an Italian heroine like Anna Magnani. Far from a Roman holiday, Lee's complex characters find themselves in a narrative that is unromantic and pragmatic from the first. The Derek Walcott epigraph suggests that this novel will be no dewy-eyed view of the peninsula. I'm going to quote a little of that epigraph here. Quote, in it is no lacrime rerum, no art, only the gift to see things as they are. End quote. Mira, too, like the characters in Lee's stories, disdains romantic notions about Italy. Quote, she long ago discovered that every American, regardless of age, race, sex, and class, has the same maudlin soft spot for Italy. The joke among Mira's expatriate friends is that the best thing about living here is coming back to the States and mentioning it. End quote. The narrator specifically mocks the Italy love plot in the novel. So this is a great quote, I think. Girls arrive and they go slightly mad. They think they've died and gone to a heaven of real men. Because I think Italians do the Latin courtship thing better than Spaniards or anybody else, all spumante and roses and making you feel like you're a natural woman, Aretha style. And then you settle down and find out that Romeo is fucking everybody but everybody else, and that his family is a pain in the arse besides. There's always some large disillusionment. But if you get through that phase, you settle down and start making a life. There can be life for U.S. women in Italy, according to Lee, but only after they reject the dewy-eyed Italy love plot. The Italy Lee's characters find themselves in is, in Mira's words, quote, smudged with age and disappointment. Her relationships echo the theme of loss. We know her youthful first marriage to Nick didn't last. We're told she's currently married to an Italian, Vanni. Her aging former Italian lover, Zenon, phones her. She can only note, quote, outdated reactions of the body, whose memory is longer than that of the heart. She ponders her continued contact with Zenon and says, it's nostalgia, not for love, of course, for being young, end quote. When Mira thinks her husband, Vanni, is having an affair, she is hardly upset. Maybe I've just lived too long, she says to a friend, but I find it hard to take it seriously. Poor Vanni, anyway. He loves me, and he's feeling old. This could be his red Porsche. In response, her friend says, as I get older, life does tend to look less like a romance and more like a farce. A summary, perhaps, of post-romance Italy. I want to add that this vision of an aging, disappointing Italy, I find throughout U.S. culture today. So I don't think this is a fully racialized image. I'm thinking of movies like Woody Allen's To Rome with Love, Paolo Sorrentino's Academy Award-winning La Grande Bellezza, and novels like Jess Walter's Beautiful Ruins. These all depict Italy as a site where aging men confront nostalgia for their lost youth and lost loves. But rather than being nostalgic for a romantic past, Lee's novel suggests that her characters may in fact be better off without those relationships, which only limit and control women's lives. So her pictures of relationships in Italy are always pretty controlling. So for instance, one character tells Mira, you don't love Zenon, it's a kind of possession. Elsewhere, Lee uses the language of property ownership to describe the relationship. When Zenon tells Mira he loves her, that means he feels he owns her. Under Zenon's spell, belonging to him, owned by him, Mira changes. She is transformed into, quote, a girl certainly not like her natural self, but mesmerizing. Finally, in an act of total control of the female body, we find out that Zenon forced Mira to have an abortion. In the face of this, Lee's story suggests ways to escape the Italy romance plot, describing ways women can move beyond the lover-beloved binary that lies at the heart of heterosexual romance. At the end of Lost Hearts, Mira escapes this binary. Despite her past marriage and current aging husband, we are told she is living, quote, a happy, crowded existence that has allowed her to sink unexpected roots into a country where she had once felt like the heroine of a melodrama, end quote. The sentence indicates that escaping the drama of the romance plot, what Lee calls the melodrama, can lead to a happy existence. The term crowded suggests that Lee uses to describe Mira's life, suggests that happiness comes from breaking out of the two-person lover-beloved binary. And Lee is clear about the freedom Mira experiences at the end of the story. Quote, Vanni doesn't ask anymore where she disappears to, just waggles his eyebrows like Groucho Marx when she returns, end quote. And in fact, the organization of Lost Hearts underscores the idea that every relationship is, quote, crowded. There are always more than two people involved. Each chapter is named after the lovers, the original married couple, Mira and Nick, and Mira's lover, Zenon. In some ways, the triangle at the center of the novel already complicates the easy lover-beloved binary. An advertisement in Goodreads emphasizes that this complication is rooted in Italian ways of thinking. It states, the Italian phrase, mai due senza tre, never two without three, forms the basis of Andrea Lee's spellbinding novel of betrayal. That's the advertisement for it. Moreover, embedded in many of these chapters, under the names of the lovers, are sections featuring the viewpoints of the people surrounding them, a Greek chorus, Lee has called it. I see this embedded technique as a suggestion that these others are part of the lovers' identities, complicating any simple individual subjectivity. Thus, in some sections, we see the viewpoints of family members, children, and friends reflecting on the actions of the lovers. Further, while this technique suggests that all identity, like Mira's racial and national identity, is complex and multiple, Lee also suggests that such complexity and multiplicity cross boundaries of gender, race, nation, and class. Many of the embedded stories are from workers around the lovers who come from all over the world. So, for example, in one Zenon chapter, a woman in a burqa living in the same northern Italian town that he does states, no one is like me here. Yet she's trying to make a life in Italy. She says, I am learning the language. Buongiorno, grazie, per amore di Dio. While surely Zenon does not understand this Italian Muslim, quote, woman without a face, symbol of foreign strangeness in his hometown, the novel suggests that even she is part of him, since, quote, it's as if he invented her himself, and he knows one night she will walk into his dreams. In an interview published at the end of Lost Hearts, Lee writes that she is trying to, quote, observe and acknowledge dispassionately as many facets of a situation as possible, to take a standard melodrama, a love triangle, and look at it through a kaleidoscope. Just as a kaleidoscope glass and mirrors into bits. Lee breaks the lover-beloved binary into bits, complicated identities to contain multitudes. In Italy, outside of the love plot, Lee's female characters expand. To conclude then, it is true that a television show like To Roam for Love indicates that the idea of romance for women in Italy is still current today, even in the face of all the problems in Italy and Italian racism. But yet, at the end, even To Roam for Love rejects the Italy love plot, much like Lee's novel. So in the very last episode, the women, the black women are all heading home. There's some suggestion maybe two of them found lovers there, but on the whole, they don't. They're all going back to the U.S., pretty much not coupled up. One woman, Nikita, says, quote, "I came to Rome to find love, but little did I know the love that I was looking for was self-love," end quote. Thus, the power of Italy, it would seem then that that the popular contemporary text show black women rejecting the long-held Italy love plot to find and expand the self. Thus, the power of Italy, the idea here, if not the actual place, remains strong in the female imaginary as a transformative space crossing racial lines. As represented in these contemporary texts, black women may not find love a la Audrey Hepburn in Italy, but they can find freedom and happiness. And remember that the real point of Roman Holiday was not Hepburn's romance with Gregory Peck, but her transformation into a strong, independent ruler at the end of the film. As I look at popular contemporary texts, I would argue Italy still exists in the American female imaginary as that place of transformative possibility, even for women of color today. Thank you.
When you were looking at Bob Viscusi's work, I know you touched on about generations living in the same household. Did he mention how, with the new generations in America not living in the same household, did that have a very big impact on how the casa is not the home in America the way it was in Italy? Was there more of an impact because of that here?
I'm not sure about this. I mean, Viscusi is just really working on the representation of the house. So in the U.S. So maybe there are other parts of the book where he is more focused on the generation. And they mentioned Barolini because you have how they relate themselves to the house, not as a physical space, but you know, as the place where they live together or where they live.
Deborah, I know you were focusing on African-American women, but I was wondering, I know later today someone's doing Jhumpa Lahiri, and I don't know if you've considered sort of black and brown women in that relationship with Italy.
She certainly does see Italy as and uses it as a transformative space. I'm really only aware of the dual written text. In other words, I think it's called something like that. And certainly... I have thought about using her. I just wasn't sure that I had enough. But it's a good point to bring her up. What she does do is see Italy, as many of these American women do, as a very much a liminal space. And what I think is that this part of liminality of Italy, racial and as well as in other ways as well, I think really is part of the reason that it is transformative to American women. So.
Jessica Mann, thank you for bringing in the question of gender. I'm especially referring to the first part of your talk because we know from other studies that Italy was an important place for African-American men. I'm thinking of Winston Hughes, Alan Locke. They experienced things, and it was an important field for experiencing new things about race. But, the gender issue makes a difference. And then I was thinking of what happened. There were African American women in Italian television in the 1950s.
I'm sorry, where?
In Italian television. Okay. There were African American actresses in Italy, but they were pigeonholed in very stereotype roles as in the United States. So I just wanted to add this.
Thank you. I don't
And that. yeah. Because maybe they married Italian men and then they continue to work in television, but in those roles.
Post-war, you're talking 1950s, you said?
Yeah,
okay.
50s and 60s. Okay. And it is interesting that when they were translated, they used often a Veneto dialect, so there was two different stereotypes applied on them. The racial stereotype, and then you have a linguistic stereotype applied on them because they had to be translated. My question for, I don't remember your name.
Francesco,
sorry. How did you select your case studies? Because they are very removed in time, and I understand maybe you wanted to show differences, but if you could tell us something more about your selection process, why those texts and not others?
I really wanted to find three very different cases in time, in the type of text, because one is a memoir, another is an autobiography, and another one is a fictional text, is a novel. And but this is again like a starting point, because I want to, of course, I want to reflect to argument on many more cases. But the diversity of those three cases for me was really interesting, and it was interesting to find the dialogue between them. Because in a way, I think there is a passage of the paper that I didn't mention before. It was the actual conclusion, because I thought I was running late. That they kind of construct a circular path. You know, it's the idea that you can find a dialogue in texts that are so different and so distant in time, in space, in the genre that they work on, for me was really significant. I thought, I mean, if I was clear enough, if you see also the circularity, the dialogue between them, I think it worked in a way. So I wanted them to be really distant and different.
I was thinking about how not only gender, indeed, which was a very important intersection in all of the pieces, but and this is a general question for each of you, because I was thinking about critical race, and in the United States, critical race studies has become very, very important in teaching anything that's intersectional, whether it's a text or a film, whatever. I was wondering how race really influenced your thinking about the books, the very different texts that you chose, Francesco. The fact that you chose Andrea Lee, and I did not know she had written a book that she sets in Italy. And again, Fabrizze has the ability to assimilate because I'm assuming he obtained some kind of form of whiteness, which makes that transition from Cleveland even into Chicago after the financial disaster possible for him in ways that it absolutely wasn't for Black Americans during that time period. Would you like to respond to anything with regard to how you were thinking about race and race identities in each of your works?
Yeah, well, I think, as I said, what happens, I started this project on the meanings of Italy to U.S. women, and everything I was finding, I was looking first at U.S. women writers and then looking at representations of women in Italy, and all I saw were white women. So, you know, it sort of was the natural question. It's like, wait a minute, what's going on here with African American women or women of color of sort of any sort? And so if anyone has any other suggestions, including the Lahiri, that was good to keep that in mind. I'm sort of open to it, but I just was... Andrea Lee was one of the only people I'd found who I think she lives in Torino now, and she has two books, actually, that she's Lost Hearts, and then she has a collection of short stories that also have a lot of women in Italy. But that's really because I didn't find much else, so I'm open to suggestions.
Concerning the coming of Fabrizze, there's no real mention of race. The only thing is that there are references to the regional differences between, for example, between Sicilians and people coming from the Abruzzi, and also the gang, the workers, had to face an Irish foreman. Okay, so here you can see the hierarchy and the different waves of migration, but there's no real reference to any Black person or any racial allusions. In 1960. And I was I didn't mention it, but I was a bit surprised because this book is so pro-assimilationist. And you know, in the 60s, I mean, the Italians or the Italian Americans were fighting for the recognition of their rights. And here it's so as if assimilation was logical and had to be implemented. So I was a bit surprised because of that.
Well, for me, it was a bit of at the beginning, this was just a paper about Italian American cases. While I was thinking about this in Berlin, I actually met Igiaba Scego, and I saw her, and I say this is just brilliant because she's just not only an African Italian, if we want to use this label, but she's also a woman, and she's absolutely brilliant as a talker. And I said, yeah, this is just this dialogue is just working so well. But you have the issue that probably you don't want to work on different direction of migration. Then when Anthony Tamburi had this talk in Calabria about how to enlarge the field, I just thought, oh, this is just what it should be. And I think that, again, the diversity that Igiaba Scego's case bring in this kind of analysis just works.
Debra, I was thinking about Camilla Hawthorne. I don't know if you are familiar with her. She's a PhD in geography at Berkeley. Yeah, and she's an African American woman, and she does write about Italy and different race issues there. So yeah, maybe she's not a fiction writer though.
Okay, but I'll take a look because
Not that I'm familiar. Do you know if she writes fiction as well? No.
No. Okay.
I don't think so.
But she reflects on it, so that would
Yeah,
be
but I was
too.
Wondering if with black voices, let's say, becoming more prominent in the Italian literary scene as well, with Igiaba Scego, but not only. Some were mentioned yesterday, for example, by Laura Lori. She talked about Cristina Farah, who's also from the Horn of Africa, and there's even young guys like Antonio Di Chele Di Stefano. So I'm wondering if with these writers becoming emerging in Italy, maybe even from America, there can be sort of an exchange, and some African Americans and African Italians can find maybe some points of in common.
Yeah. I wonder how it's going to evolve, because right now it still seems pretty much. I was so surprised to see that TV show on the black women traveling to Italy to find love. There's just not a lot of representations of that. So maybe you're right, though. It'll change and evolve with this. So,
I was also just a quick note on for Marie Christine. The spelling of Fabrizzi is really weird, isn't it? It's not very Italian. Did you think about this?
I was just wondering if it was not from the Abruzzi only, because Fabrizio in Italian,
it's usually with an I at the end. And also, usually not
E.
Double Z, which is all right, but
there's an E at the end.
Yeah, which Fabrizio. Is not very, if you look it up, I quickly did a Google search, and the only mention is this book. And usually the Italian spelling is with an I at the end. I'm not familiar with the author at all. And so I was wondering how assimilated into America was he when he wrote this book already? Because this is it's more like an American spelling to me.
No, I just thought the name was a bit weird, but I couldn't, I didn't check,
okay.
Really.
Yeah, it's just minor comment on the side that, the spelling is a bit.
I have questions / suggestions for Debra Bernardi, since we're talking about possible additions to your project. I was wondering, because if you're talking, it's not apparently not so closely related, but since you're talking about blackness and womanhood in Italy, I was wondering if you are interested in having a look at, let's say, the women that the women you're talking about get mistaken for. That is to say, the African victims of the contemporary sex trade, and which is it is very interesting the way in which these two stories that are completely separate get connected in a way by stereotype and racism, because I mean the contemporary sex trade from Nigeria is a story that deserves to be told. There's a beautiful couple of chapters in Cristiana Giordano's Migrants in Translation book from 2014 about ethnopsychiatry in contemporary Italy, and she talks about victims of sex trade, and I mean the way in which basically, unsurprisingly, the women you talk about get mistaken for them. I think it's something that deserves to be explored, this connection, so I was wondering.
I have not looked into that. It seems a lot, at that moment. But yeah. But you're absolutely right that it's important to look at that. So that's a great good idea.